The GT4-Pack was the next DLC in line after the Intercontinental GT series, and it just got released. So today we are going to take a quick peek on what Kuno's changed in ACC's menus to enable an easy to understand user interface regarding multi-class racing, but more importantly, also which cars are featured in the new extension. If you boot up Assetto Corsa Competizioni, everything should look as usual, but if you enter the multiplayer section, a new bar underneath the car selection was added and is separated into 5 segments: Primary, GT3, GT4, Cup and ST. They are needed to select a car for every given class in the game. Regarding Primary, the car selected there is going to be the one you get when you join a server that has multi-class racing enabled. So if you have selected the McLaren as a GT4 car, the BMW as a GT3 car, and the GT4 McLaren again as your primary, and you join a multi-class server, then you'll drive the McLaren in the GT4 category. The other two classes, Super Trofeo and Cup, are more or less just useful for selecting a livery, as both of them feature only a single car. Now we are moving on to the more juicier part of the video, a short overview of the new cars. So let's start right off with the Austrian brand KTM and their GT4 Crossbow. First off, this car looks rather strange in its GT4 variation, as the normal street version is an open wheeler, where an additional roof, so to say, had to be fitted on for safety reasons. The KTM is rather lightweight, which is noticeable in corners, as it has massive grip and is very stable, but seems to struggle a bit on longer straights due to a slight lack of top end speed. It is probably one of the easiest cars to drive in the GT4 class, as it is very forgiving and consistent. The Chevrolet Camaro GT4R, on the other hand, is the polar opposite of the KTM. It's one of the GT4's big boys, rather heavy, and has the longest gears of all cars. Because of its weight, it's prone to understeer and therefore also a bit difficult to drive smoothly, but the classic American default engine, a V8, sounds simply the best among the GT4s and delivers enough power for the Camaro to be a threat on longer straights. The Maserati is a bit of an outlier, as it interestingly doesn't feature ABS or traction control and therefore requires smooth inputs, especially regarding braking, to get up to pace. Other than that, it is another lightweight beast that feels quick and has lots of potential if, as I said before, you can consistently be smooth enough. Its only real downside would probably be wet races, as they typically are very demanding on the ABS and traction control side. So this is quite strange, and I couldn't come up with an explanation myself, but the Ginetta is by far the best GT4 regarding braking, as one can brake insanely late with this car. And the funny thing is, even though you can brake very late and deep in the corners, it doesn't unsettle the car noticeably more. And it doesn't end there. The Ginetta is undoubtedly the easiest car to drive, while simultaneously being quick, as it is forgiving, very stable, and feels just nice overall. The only downside is its steering wheel being on the right side, which takes a bit of time to get used to. Next, we have the BMW M4 GT4, but I'm not going to lose too much words about it, as it basically feels almost exactly like its brother in the GT3 class. It still feels insanely heavy, you still feel like the track is way too small for this big boy, it is still below average in corners, but still earns its place as a powerhouse. So if you did like the BMW M6 or the Bentley in the higher GT3 tier, then the M4 is your car. But if you are a bit like me and prefer cornering speed and stability over power, then I'd recommend you skip this vehicle. Another GT4 exclusive brand in ACC is Alpine. So this car is probably the most sensitive, as its behavior is all over the place, and to get the most out of it, you definitely need to practice a lot. It feels like the Alpine is only able to be competitive when driven in a tiny operational window, where it's understeer heavy when below and gets ridiculously unstable when slightly above. In the few laps I decided to stick with it, I wasn't really able to get it right. So yeah, the Alpine is one hell of a diva and requires lots of training and fine-tuning. The Aston Martin Vantage V8 GT4 is also quite similar to its GT3 counterpart, first and foremost, it has the second best engine sound right after the Camaro. Handling wise, the Aston is very stable, forgiving, and a perfect car for beginners, as you can really push it, trying to find its limits without instantly losing massive amounts of time. It is probably one of the most balanced cars in this class, as it corners nicely and the V8 produces a significant amount of power. Next, we have the Audi R8 LMS in its GT4 variant. Now, believe it or not, but the GT4 version feels even better than the GT3, as the latter tends to be rather twitchy at the apex and corner exits. The GT4 version, however, is a lot more stable and consistent. Additionally, it has a nice acceleration thanks to really short gears, is lightweight, and can really be pushed to its limit. So far, this is probably the fastest car with the highest potential out of this class, similar to the GT3 Porsche. The only drawback is that the Audi sometimes gets a bit twitchy under braking, or rather at the turn-in, but apart from this, it provides a great driving experience. For the Mercedes, it's basically the same as for the BMW. It doesn't really differ from the GT3 version, and they run the same philosophy. The best thing about it is probably its ability to be fast, even though you think your lap was slow. It definitely has lots of potential, but really unlock it is another story, as its general behavior is oversteery and it hasn't the best traction. So you need to carefully modulate the throttle and try to leave the traction control out of the equation. If you are already fast in the GT3, then you'll also be in the GT4. And if you haven't driven it yet, you should give it a shot, as it is an above average car that doesn't require all too much practice. The McLaren 570S is quite different to its GT3 counterpart. While the 720S is a lightweight, high downforce car that gets most of its lap time out of corners, the 570S is a lot heavier, but also has more power and straight line speed to offer. But in comparison to other heavy cars in the GT4 class, the McLaren is stable like no other. Yes, you are a bit slower in corners, but the overall behavior is nevertheless nice and steady. You just have to trust the car, as it really is able to actually take corners quite a bit faster than its initial feedback would suggest. Lastly, we have the Porsche 718 Cayman Club Sport. And I don't know how they do it, but Porsche always managed to provide a highly competitive car for every category they compete in. The Cayman is very lightweight, fast on the straights, and able to corner amazingly. However, instead of the snappiness of the GT3 Porsche, it has a tendency to understeer out of corners after a good initial turn-in. But all in all, I'm convinced that it has the potential to be in the upper half of the board if driven by a somewhat decent driver. In the end, my personal top 5 would be the Porsche, Mercedes, Audi, McLaren and the Ginetta, where Porsche is the number one. But ultimately, different cars function better under different driving styles. And someone might like a more oversteery car, while others despise this trait. What I'm trying to say is that everyone should try out every car for themselves and get an own impression of them, as this video is just a short overview, as I said in the beginning. So yeah, this is basically it for this video. If you did enjoy it, or could get something useful out of it, you could consider subscribing to this channel for more sim racing content. And with that said, I'll catch you in the next one. Cheers!